We're live.
Okay, I've pushed the record button. So, take it off this camera, take it on this camera. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 399 and 7/8. Gary's coming soon. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. Today we're going to have a brief episode, probably 40 minutes or so. That's about all the time I've got, but we're going to do... continuing on our series of DMR episodes, we're going to set up a ZumSpot. Today in studio with me.
Hey.
There's Darren. There I am. Darren's back.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Darren. Thanks for joining me again.
Thanks for having me. We're looking away from each other, but we're technically sitting. I'm looking at David, even though it looks like I'm looking
away. I forgot. I flip the cameras so that we can look this way. So that we're looking
David.
At you.
Hey.
Exactly.
Okay. It's all good. No worries.
That is so funny. So today, and I'm going to move this thing away because it's going to be in the way, and I'm going to move this thing away.
It's all the magic off screen that the viewers at home don't see.
The real important guest today.
Yes, it's that little guy.
It's this. It's the ZumSpot. And it's set up and ready to go, but we're going to reset it up and make it ready to go. And I think the first thing we should tell folks is, what do they need? They need one of these.
Yes. Yes. You're going to need the ZumSpot. And you're going to need a Raspberry Pi.
And which one is this?
That is the 2. Sorry. That is the 3B, not the 3B Plus. I ran into an issue with the 3B Plus, which apparently the ZumSpot people have a beta version out that will work. But I ran into an issue with the power supply not being powerful enough, and I think I may have screwed up my 3B Plus. So we're going to go with the 3B. It'll work with a 2B. It'll work with the 3B. I think the key is you want something with Wi-Fi, and the reason we're using this one instead of the Pi Zero, which is also something you can use, is that if we want to be able to plug it in to the network, the Pi Zero does not have an Ethernet port on it. So
and that'll be important for me.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, it's just nice to have that kind of connectivity. But they all have Wi-Fi, so you can use Wi-Fi. It's a little harder to set up, though.
Or you could plug
Wi-Fi.
In. There's the port.
Yeah. So we'll do that.
We're
for
on the
our
Wi-Fi
setup.
Right now.
Yeah.
You'll need one of these. Micro SD card.
Little guy.
It's a little... He's small.
It's a, you know, pretty...
Are you going to focus on me?
Yeah. No. It's going to be a big blur.
Oh, there it
goes. There it is.
Upside down. Ta-da, 32
I don't think
gig.
You really need that big a one. You can probably get away with an 8 or a 16. But
yeah, this is just a dummy for the show because this one will actually end up in my truck in the dash
cam.
That's all good.
Yeah.
But we are going to actually set it up. And then for the PC, you'll need one of these to slip it in there so that you can do your thing. So let's get started.
Awesome.
I am going to try. Let's see if we can use the rendezvous to...
Show my screen. We're gonna need.
I don't even know how to do that. You're gonna share your screen, right?
Screen should be shared. So you just need to figure out how to get that full screen.
That was a good question.
Probably it needs to be a source or something like that. That's my guess.
I have no idea. Nope.
Is it not in the menu?
Oh
of
yeah,
sources?
It's gotta be. I've kind of like set it up here.
It's okay.
So smart. Rendezvous, Darren's computer.
That's the one.
We're going to add you in as a new, look.
Hey, look at that. And
there's
pow.
Darren's computer. Boom. And I got to take this away.
Kill that lower third. Awesome.
Lower third's away.
Okay.
So what are we talking about? What are we looking at here?
Okay. We're going to need some software because you can't do much without the software. So I've already inserted the card and I'm just going to double check that it showed up in my list of things here. And I've got this SDHC card and it's formatted via, you know, its stock formatting. But we want to format it differently. We actually want to use a program called Memory Card Formatter. And I believe it's from the SD Association. I'm just giving you guys the webpage here. But
yeah, that's where you're at.
Ultimately, what it looks like, the software itself, is it looks like this. So here, let me move all this
and
stuff out
of the way.
And
it's all free, right?
It's all free. Yeah, cool. Everything's free. So first thing we're going to do, we're going to format the card. We're going to go this little drop down. It says select D. Let's just be sure we're not formatting
you
something
don't
else.
Format your
I don't want to format the operating system. So if it says C, you probably want to step back. So we're going to just do a quick format. You may or may not need to really do this, but everything I've read says you do. So quick format tells us that it did it.
It's
everybody's
probably,
happy.
Probably a good idea.
Ta-da.
Just
okay.
Wipe it out.
The most important software that we're going to need, actually, is the PiStar software. So we're going to go to it's PiStar, so PiStar.uk. And the program that we want to download under, where is it? It's in here somewhere. PiStar Tools. Oh, downloads, excuse me, is download PiStar. I've already downloaded it, but just to kind of give you guys an idea of what's going on here. That's, we have the RPi 3, so we want this guy.
It's the, important to get the right one for
you. Yeah, because they got the Nano, they got the Orange Pi. There's all kinds of stuff here. And they give you instructions on how to go about doing all this kind of stuff. But anyways, I just wanted to show everybody that. And then we're going to need one other program here to actually flash, sorry, I probably could have left that up, flash the software onto the chip, which is this program called Etcher. It's etcher.io, another free program. And what it basically does is it just images the PiStar software onto the flash card. So we formatted our flash card. I can close this. Our SD card, I keep calling it a flash card. Those are old, right? Those are from
micro SD.
Right? Yeah. Yeah. All right. So we're going to select our image. And hey, look at that. It's right. The only thing I got in there.
That's just a standard ISO, right?
Yeah, I believe so. Okay. Yeah. Doesn't actually give me the suffix on here.
Yeah,
but
it's because it's hidden. But that, I'm sure you're right. That's probably what it is.
It's viewable by Etcher. Yep. So it's a dot image.
Oh, IMG. Okay.
And it sees the Samsung card.
Excellent.
And we're going to start cooking it. And it's going to, of course, prompt me saying that I'm doing something scary. So it'll take a few minutes, probably. Well, it's starting. So let's see. Any cat videos to watch while we're waiting? Do you?
No? I could bring up a cat video.
I'm just joking.
I'm not going to do that today, though.
So we were using cat videos to test the system earlier today.
So should we power this guy down and take the
why not
card out?
So it's 19%. Here, you can put the. Oh, there you go. That's fine. You guys can't see anything right now.
Yeah,
you
so
just see me.
So while it's flashing, I'm going to go back to
something
to
more
my
interesting.
Demo cam.
There we go.
So I had this set up with a different card. So unplugged it because, of course, I don't want to do anything while it's plugged in. I'm going to pull the other card, the old card out. Now, I don't have a case for this yet, but I will eventually get a case.
Yeah, they make a kind of an interesting case. I got one off of Amazon for the Pi 3. It looked really cool, but it ended up being like 50 pieces.
Yeah.
You know, so it was
stacked.
Yeah.
And a lot of work.
A little stacked. But it looks great. But if I ever have to switch anything out, then it's going to be like in 20 minutes worth of work.
If you go and get the ZumSpot is basically this little whiteboard that you see here and the antenna. The Raspberry Pi is the green board here, and they give you some little standoffs, and it just goes right onto
the GPIO
header.
Pins. Yeah.
Yep. The header. And it's all ready to go. Don't got to do any soldering or anything. Now, this is SMA, I think.
Reverse SMA.
So you could, and we're going to play around this at some point later on.
Put a better antenna on.
Yeah, we could get a little whip that goes to a better antenna, and I could even like plug this in on my roof.
Yeah.
And we could get this covering the whole neighborhood.
It's I think the output's like 10 milliwatts, so it's really not very powerful. So yeah, a good antenna could help.
Yeah.
The one thing to know about the Raspberry Pi, if you guys haven't used them before, I mean, they're really cool. I've built all kinds of fun things with them. Make sure to get these little heat sinks. I don't know if you can see that right there in there.
Oh, yeah,
they're just stick-on heat sinks, but the Raspberry Pis get a little hot. What it'll do is it'll kind of...
There.
Yeah, it may shut itself down. I don't think the ZumSpot is really cooking the processor.
And this is the lower quality one. You can get the one that has that you can kind of see here.
And what was interesting in the case that I got, they gave me a real heat sink for the bottom. But normally with the cases, you have to use that little flat heat sink because you won't be able to put it in the case.
Got it.
Because it'll be too big.
Just cut a hole.
You could. And that's what they did on this case that I bought. And they sent me an extra heat sink as well. So it was kind of nice.
I may get a bigger box. It may not look as pretty, but.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. You put it in,
put
make
a
custom
fan
box.
In there and
3D print your own.
Oh, there's something to buy.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you got nice maker space in town. I'll tell you about it.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Hex.io or Hex Labs.
It's
like
downtown,
like
right?
It's actually in Chatsworth.
Oh,
it's awesome. Cool. I'll give them a little plug because I really like them. Okay, so we're done flashing the card. If you want to switch back over.
Okay.
You don't have
card flashing.
Yep, card. There we go. It says flash another. So if you want to, you know, do a bunch, you can do it there. So we're done there. So I guess the next thing to do, since we've got everything on the card, is actually, I guess you don't really need to go back to my computer because now we're going to physically install it. So I'm going to eject the card.
And we're
going
to go back to the demo cam, hand cam. Here's the handy cam.
All right, stand by. Ejecting. I don't want to just pull it out, even though it probably doesn't matter. It's not writing anything. Okay, safe to remove hardware.
Ta-da. Okay, so we're going to take out the handy-dandy sleeve, pop this guy out.
Yep.
We're going to turn it over and apply the card thusly. And then we will find the power and repower it. This one's upside down.
That's the right one.
And you can see lots of flashy lights.
And plug in the Ethernet.
Plug in the Ethernet,
yeah.
Too. Uh-oh.
Well, you don't have to, but it just a lot easier. I think it goes into its own hotspot mode where you can log on to it.
It does.
And for most people, if you're using the Pi Zero, that's an extra step there where you actually have to log on to its Wi-Fi, and then you can administer it from there. Let's see.
So I'm going to go back to Darren's laptop.
Okay.
Because we're going to find the...
Yes, so once it boots up, it takes a few minutes, not a few minutes, but I don't know, maybe 30 seconds. You're going to look at the top of the Pi Star, and it will, I believe that once that light is, it'll start blinking some of the lights there. It's not seeing your Ethernet connection to the bad cable. A ham with a bad cable. Oh. I can't see the other side, so.
Well,
there's that other blue cable that you had earlier that we threw.
That's the one.
Oh.
I've got another one. But wait, there's more. Here, I got this yellow one.
So I'm going to take a moment here while he's looking into this. I just wanted to mention a couple things from the last DMR special we had. Yeah, well, you know, I learned a couple things from that because a couple of the viewers were really helpful and gave me some insight into DMR that I didn't know.
Wait, we got spanked is really
what happened. No, actually, I thought they were very nice. And seriously, and I actually was surprised that this was the only thing that anybody actually mentioned that we got wrong. Maybe try restarting the Pi Star again one more time, just see what happens. Anyways, I just want to say, apparently, D-Star is not proprietary. It's and neither is anything. I guess the only one that's really proprietary is Yaesu.
I knew that. I wasn't paying attention.
Yeah, that's all good. So, you know, I take that back. Also, I'd mentioned something about the Pi, and I said this earlier, about the Pi 3 Plus, the 3B Plus not being compatible. They do have a beta version on here, and I don't see it in here, but my guess is it's somewhere on the... PiStar.uk website, they have a beta for us. And then the last thing is, for some of the repeaters, we figured out, actually I figured out because I went on the DMR net from Papa Network, that they do actually have a line, they call it, Papa calls it the XLX013, and that talk group ties into their analog repeater, which is really nice, but it didn't work the other day, and I guess it's somewhat problematic. So, in theory, it's really nice when it works.
Okay, so, for whatever reason...
All right, well, it's not working,
we'll
but...
Go Wi-Fi.
Let's go Wi-Fi. Let's see what happens. I have yet to...
I don't remember if the Pi remembers that it was set up for the...
Wi-Fi. No, there's no memory on the Pi. I mean, there's you know, regular, like, RAM, but... Yeah. All right, let's see here. If I see the Pi, I don't know what it would be called. Also, could be that we didn't flash it properly.
Okay, that's possible.
That's always a possibility. Something went wrong with the flashing of the memory. This is the great thing about live demos, though.
Dun, dun, dun. We'll go back to the... Oh, nothing there.
Yeah, I'm just looking... Trying to reseat the card.
Got to do this all on screen. That's all. I'm just kidding.
All right. So my guess is it didn't flash the card correctly because you see how you just have a red light
there?
It's
not booting.
Can you guys see me? I don't see that. It's not booting. So something went wrong with the flash.
Bummer.
try it one more time here. Okay, you want to see a green light blinking as well. But the nice thing is that we have a pre-flashed card, so we can still go through the settings.
Yep. We should probably do that.
Yeah. Interesting that that didn't work. While we're going through the settings, I'll see if I can reflash this one.
Yeah. All right, so I'll swap that. Go with the dummy card.
Grab.
It's because I bought that ST card. It's from Fry's Electronics.
Oh well, that's it was open box.
Oh look, no, it was the box was closed, but it was Fry's.
So this one, yeah. Oh, now you can see it's look, got both lights.
It's booting.
And my guess is if you plug in the Ethernet, it will work. You don't need to because we already set this one up for Wi-Fi. But
so we should go back to Darren's PC.
Yep, you can go back to my PC, and this is from before, so I'm waiting for it to boot up again. Right. It just kept the screen from when we were doing this earlier.
And you should probably log into it.
Okay.
And we should go through.
So
the
now
settings.
We're logged in. Ta-da. This is it. Did you change your password from the default password yet on there, or no?
I can't remember.
Then I'm going to guess no. So let's give it a shot. All right. So when you want to log it, once you get this connected and you've got it to your, you know, plugged in with the Ethernet, again, we already have it set up with Wi-Fi, but you should get the same thing. You're going to go to pi-star.local, and it may actually complain that it's an unsecure connection and all this kind of stuff. Like you can see up here in the corner, it says not secure. You're on your local network, so don't worry about that. You're not going to get like hacked into or anything. You're actually logging onto a little web server that's inside of the Pi itself. So you'll go to pi-star.local. And most of this will be, it's actually going to give you a screen that says, you know, you haven't enabled this. It'll give you some on-screen instructions. But ultimately what you want to get to, of course, it's not going to be that because that's my PyStar. So PyStar, and the password is Raspberry. That's the original password.
I bet I did change it.
But you could try.
Let's give it a shot.
Yep.
Nope, you never changed it. So it's still on the default.
Okay, good.
Okay, now we've already got some things enabled here, but what you're going to want to do, first thing here is the MMDVM host configuration. All of these will be turned off, and you're going to want to turn on the modes that you want. In our case, David's got a DMR mode, and he's got a Yaesu as well. So we enabled DMR and Yaesu. If you have a D-Star radio, or if you have all of them, you can turn them off, turn them all on. The only thing I've been told, well, I haven't been told, but I read on the internet, is that if you do more than two or three of them, the Pi has a bit of a hard time.
Yeah, so I was going to ask, is there a disadvantage to having them all on?
Is it
an overheating thing?
I don't know if it's an overheating thing or just a performance issue where, you know, one doesn't work as well. We can experiment with that, and we'll get back to you guys on one of these future shows.
Yeah, we'll do another show. Yeah. I think we'll focus today on DMR, and then we'll do a Fusion one. And
The general configuration, with the stuff up here, controller software and controller mode, you can leave those where they are. MMDV host and simplex node should be fine unless, you know, you're doing something where you want a repeater, like a duplex repeater, D-Star repeater. But in this case, we just want to keep it where it is. Hang times, leave them where they are. And basically, we're going to come down here to general settings. Now, general settings will not be completely populated with all of these options until you enable certain things like your DMR ID. This will not show up here until you've turned on DMR mode. So, and then also don't forget, hit apply changes. So once you switch these little toggles, hit apply changes, it goes to, you know, maybe a 10-second little reboot sort of thing and comes back up. So you got your general settings. Host name can stay PyStar. There's no need to change that. That's basically what you're logging into up here. So pi-star.local. If you change this to, you know, pi-star5.local, then you just put that up there.
So if you had multiple units, you'd want to
exactly
change them out.
Yeah, so you can get to each one. Your call sign. That's your call sign. And then your DMR ID, which for, you know, we talked about this in the other episode. You need to register for this ID. And it takes, well, it took me about 24 hours to get mine back, but I think David's came back and
it was about half that time when I got mine back.
Cool.
But I did it late one night, so maybe they come in the morning and do it then.
Yeah. Radio frequency, as we saw in the last show, I had mine as 500. Don't do that. That's actually not supposed to be. 441.025 is allocated in our area for the band plan for this sort of communication. Enter in your longitude and your latitude. You can get this from your cell phone. If you have an iPhone, you just go to the Compass app, and it will tell you what your longitude and latitude is. And if actually, let me see.
The Android phones will do that, too.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm not an Android person, although I do actually like Android.
Hey, let's show that on the
Yeah, that's what I was going to go and look and see. So, yeah, if you look at David's, there's mine. I can't see if mine's actually on the camera or not.
Yep, here.
Okay, yeah, you hold both of them.
Uh-oh. Why did mine just time out? Because it's not
because it's not an iPhone. No, okay.
So yeah, so I can tap into the, oops, yeah,
yeah. So anyways, the number's on the bottom. You can probably get it from just Googling it as well, because it'll get your GPS location from your router. And you know, this is actually for the APRS feature, I believe. Mm-hmm. Put in your town, so Woodland Hills, and then this was just a suggestion from somebody online that you just, you know, comma and then put in your grid square.
Right.
Country, again, suggested to put California, comma, United States, even though that's, you know, the state and country. And then here where it talks about URL, this is basically, you can put anything in here that you want it to link to if somebody else is logging on. One of the options elsewhere is if they're on your homepage, they can click on it and it'll bring up your profile. So in your case, you put it to QRZ, and then if you know, go to W0DHG, that's David's QRZ profile.
Right.
Here's important. This is the modem type. Now, we got the ZumSpot, but as you can see, there are a ton of different possible pi hats that will work. The DV Mega, the Teensy Zoom, obviously ZumSpot. Anyways, Micronode. We really like the ZumSpot just because it was easy and
they had it in stock.
They had it in stock.
At HRO.
Yeah, exactly. Public and private node. Private will only allow the person with this DMR ID to connect to the ZumSpot. So if you have anybody else that wants to use the ZumSpot or, you know, use PiStar, ZumSpot, whatever hat you have, you want to put that on public. And I mean, you know, theoretically, yeah, somebody driving down the street or whatever could also get onto it, but you know, we're all hams. We're trustworthy, right?
I'm willing to share.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and then that lets us, you know, you and I able to test it and stuff. Although right. I forgot to bring my DMR radio today, so yeah, we're not going to get much of a test there. But
so we'll get the parrot test.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And then your time zone, and then your language. So then you want to hit apply, which since we've got all that set up, great, we're done. You've got your DMR configuration. You're going to bring down this drop down, and it's going to give you a lot of options because the DMR range around the world. In our case, we want
the Brandmeister.
It's a BM for Brandmeister, United States 3101. I haven't experimented with these other ones, but I'm guessing that they essentially do the same thing. And then you can see there's DMR Plus. There's also like DMR gateway. I don't really know all of the stuff here, so you guys can clue us in on the comments what the rest of these places are. But my guess is if you want Brandmeister Switzerland, click on Brandmeister Switzerland if you're in Switzerland. And then, yeah, I think you leave the rest of this, the embedded LC only and dump data. I think these are the defaults. Color code is 1 at this point. I think there might be other, you know, check with the Brandmeister network for what it's supposed to be. And everything pretty much, again, it's default. So you'll hit apply settings. And then we tried the Yaesu. Did we have a successful test of that? I don't remember.
Because I couldn't find my radio.
Oh.
But I did find it. It's in the house, but
okay,
not right now.
Anyways.
Next time.
Yeah. And again, there's D-Star, there's other settings as well, but we didn't have radios that do that, so we haven't gotten there yet. But really the important thing is once you get this flashed and once you get this going, you can, you know, start. There's tons of resources online for figuring out how to set them up right. Another thing to understand about is the firewall configuration, dashboard access, all of this stuff. If you want it to be public, you can do that. I'm paranoid about internet security, so I like to keep things private myself. Universal plug and play, UPnP, keep off. Again, that's one of those things in your router at home. If you have UPnP on, it's actually a security vulnerability. People can hack into you using UPnP. So just a, you know, public service announcement there. Then apply changes. And then the most important thing for what we would have to deal with today is if you want to get your Wi-Fi set up, you do that here. And what you're going to do is, I'm not going to hit the reset, but you're going to do configure Wi-Fi, and it's going to bring up this page. You're going to put in your SSID and your PSK password. You can also scan the network, and it'll bring up a little prompt.
You could do that, because as long as you don't save the changes.
Yeah, I won't. And then you can add as many networks as you want. I thought I hit click on scan, but it's not doing anything.
Yeah.
Oh, probably because it's on Wi-Fi, so it probably kicked us off there. Yep, there it goes. All right, so you can see these are all the different, you know, networks. You can select it. You can select it.
Boot you off.
There we go. And it'll put a, it'll keep adding more networks to it. So, you know, if you bring this to work and take it home or whatever. So I'm going to delete the second Gmain here.
As long as you don't save it, it won't matter.
Yeah, it shouldn't matter.
And my assumption is if I bring this to work, it's not going to connect to anything because they're not going to let me on.
They're not going to give you the password?
No, I don't think
so. Or
they
think probably blacklisted devices like IoT.
I'm sure this would show up and they'd come and visit me. And
yeah,
just say, what are you doing?
Yeah. And then once you're done, you do save and connect. And then if you're plugged in with your Ethernet cable, once it does the save and connect, it's recommended that you restart the actual Wi-Fi there. So, and then, yeah, it'll show up. You'll log back on to pystar.local. And you'll see, you know, the WLAN and get your IP address and all that good stuff. So, and then the other thing that's really important to do for any time you get a Raspberry Pi for whatever is just change the password. It's always going to be Pi and Raspberry or Pi something or another and Raspberry.
Right.
If you use the Raspbian software, it's, you know, Pi is the login and Raspberry is the, password.
I'll fix that.
But, yeah, I don't think anybody's going to be hacking into your... And if they hack into your DMR radio...
They have to be right here anyways.
Yeah, it would be.
Yeah,
it's all good. Or on your network, so...
Yep.
And then once all that's set up, I mean, that's really all we had to do. There's much more advanced settings that you can go to. Well, we could do a factory reset and build this from scratch, but let's not.
No, let's not. On the other card after we reflash it.
There's the admin page. This gives you a little bit more, you know, insight and into, you know, some of the modes. Tells you the temperature.
Oh, yeah, what's the temperature?
124.7.
All right.
That feels about right.
Okay.
It's a hot day out here.
I think it's hot.
In the valley.
84 degrees.
I know.
I'm just joking around.
Let's see. There's this update here. So if you click on, I'm not going to do it right now, but that'll actually download the latest updates. You can power cycle it. You can look at live logs.
So let's look at the live logs.
So live logs will just give you basically what's going on in real time.
So I'm
going
to turn on my radio. Nope, I just showed it to the live cam, but it's not doing anything because the live cam's not being shown. So it's start logging. Should I say something?
That's just internal logs. No, this actually does show up with a... Okay, see? It popped
up. This is W0DHG testing on Parrot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
I mean, guess this is not going to work right now, and I'll tell you why in a second. Nope, maybe not.
Testing on Parrot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Awesome. And then you can see all those logs pop back up. The reason why I was guessing it wasn't going to work is frequently, what I've noticed is that you actually kind of have to key up first one time to enable a talk group.
I did that before.
Ah, see? Okay. But if you key it up and you try your Parrot or you try and talk to a talk group and no one's responding and it doesn't get through, it's because that first key up actually turns on the dynamic talk group. We talked about dynamic and static talk groups on the last podcast.
Right.
The dynamic talk groups kind of have to be woken up. So that first keying of your radio, you know, tells the PyStar or whatever, you know, DMR repeater you're on, hey, you know, I want to be connected to you. So then you'll key up and then key up again. A lot of times what'll happen when you key up the first time on a talk group is you'll hear somebody talking right away because they, you know, you now subscribed essentially to that dynamic talk group. And so that was the live log. If you go back to the dashboard, it actually gives you a nice little prettier log. You can see here the time, you know, time slot, call sign, which 9990 is actually the Parrot call talk group. So, and then it gives you your information here.
So it showed on the bottom line that I talked, and then it showed on the top line that I received it.
Yep. And if you do it again, you'll see these will dynamically change as, you know, if you key it up again, should.
Let's do that just for fun.
Go for it.
This is W0DHD talking on my ZumSpot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yep. And so you saw right there, it went to TX, and then when it comes back, it's transmitting to you, so 9980.
W0DHD talking on my ZumSpot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yeah, close enough.
Because I don't.
We have visitors coming.
Space invaders.
Yes.
Okay. So we got that. Let's show. Is this important to show? Let's see. So we got that. We got my TYT MD380 and it's set to Parrot.
Yes.
And
that's something else to know. You need to set up in your code plug the frequency and all of that, which we did on the last one. I don't know if you can show your screen with your code. Oh, we need that other computer that we set it up on.
Yeah, unfortunately, my laptop is not
No worries. But I can probably show it on mine. We'd have to.
You got your other. Yeah, we can. I can.
I don't have my radio, but I can at least kind of show you guys where
you can show the setup.
Would do it. Yeah.
And we're gonna only have a short amount of time, and I gotta.
Yep. That's all good.
Look out of here. So here's the software, and. We showed a little bit of this last time.
We showed a little bit of this last time. Yeah, you're gonna set up your contact.
Very complicated.
It is. It is overly complicated. But you know what? It's a complicated system. So, yep. You're gonna set up a digital contact, which is going to be for the talk group, and you're gonna set it up. Parrot is a private call. So what I would do here is I basically open up my contact 2, which is this is all just the default stuff. Parrot, and then. 9990, right? Okay. I'm going to say, great. That's fine. And you'll see here now you have a Parrot talk group. Then you'll go, and in this case, you're going to want to set up a receive group for this guy. And it's not, because this is a private contact, it's not going to have a receive group. Okay, never mind. Then you're going to go to your channel, and this has a ton of default channels, so we'll just pick channel 1, and we're going to keep it that. We'll call it Parrot. We're going to set our frequency, which is already 144.025 for the send, transmit, and receive. I actually was on online today, and there was a conversation going on about the admin criteria, and somebody was saying, my radio performs really poorly. It takes a few seconds for me to be able to key up onto a repeater. And it turned out, because he was actually using his radio in a very polite way, he had it on channel free, which, again, will wait for the channel to be free before the radio actually allows you to transmit. But what happens is when it's super busy, it's really hard to get in. So he ended up setting it to always, but there's some etiquette there. Basically, we'll keep the RX group in the group list 1, and our contact will be Parrot. Our color code will be 1, and we want to be on repeater slot 2. I think all of the, no matter what group it is, if you're using the ZumSpot or a hotspot like that, you want it on group 2. The rest of it can stay the same, and then you're going to go ahead and flash your radio,
flash
which
radio.
I don't have a radio, yeah. So no device. I forgot mine. Oh, well. Anyways, that's how you'd set it up in the software. And then you're going to set that up for each talk group. So you'll have, if you're going to use a local talk group and you're going to have a California and SoCal and whatever other, we're in here in California, but if you're somewhere else, there's a million different talk groups you can subscribe to. And so anyways, you're going to set up one of those, in this case, digital contacts for every talk group that you want.
And that's primarily so you don't, every time you want to talk to your ZumSpot, you don't have to switch back to the other group.
Well, because you got to have, so you're going to set up a digital contact for every talk group you want. You might have 10 talk groups that you frequently use.
Yep.
Those will be applicable to every channel. You're going to probably end up having hundreds of channels
right. For
every frequency. So, your ZumSpot will just be one of many quote unquote repeaters that you will talk to.
Right.
But if your local repeater is on a different frequency, you're going to need to set up a specific channel for every single talk group that is related to that repeater. And if you want, you know, that's where the whole zones come into play.
Got
and
when
you set up a zone and you put those channels into that zone. So if you're on your ZumSpot, you'll set up a ZumSpot zone or a hotspot zone, and you'll just put that, you know, those 5 or 10 or 16 channels in that zone.
The ones you use all the time, and then that way you just flip through. Right. Like on my radio, which was a little different than your radio, you can see there's the channel buttons, and so I'm on 16, and you know, you can flip through the 15 or so channels that are on there, and
yeah,
then that way you'd have it on
yeah,
that one that you're listening to all the time, and you put the primaries
yeah
on.
Otherwise it gets overwhelming when you have 300
channels,
because
then you have to go to the menu and then you have to go to your contacts and then change all the yeah channels out.
And a lot of times now when you download a code plug, like the code plug you downloaded, it already had a hotspot pre-programmed into it.
Right.
I think that's kind of a common thing now, is that people just put a hotspot zone in there and then they pre-build those 16 channels with talk groups that are related, you know, like on our case, the Papa Network.
Cool.
Yeah. Right. I think
that's pretty
really,
much it, right?
That's pretty much it as far as I can
excellent
think
so
of for the moment.
Let's roll it back to us. Hi, we're here. This was hey a not talking head episode, but that's okay.
Yeah,
that's
you know,
a good
we're,
thing.
We're learning.
Yep. So I want to thank y'all for joining. I know it's been a little while since we had an episode. I got another one or two lined up for the next week or two, so there'll be some more content coming and probably some more on this.
Eventually, like you'll hit episode 400, I think.
I think pretty soon.
Yeah, you're going to be like 9/10.
Had to actually call off Gary.
15th, but, 16th.
Yeah, we're going to start growing into the 30 seconds or whatever. quick pick for us. If you like what we're doing and want to support us, please visit amradionow.tv and find Arvin, our chief financial officer, click the pig and send us some love and some finances. And you know, the reality is we're putting out as much content as I can. It's hard, but I think the big thing is supporting the show will help support the 300 plus episodes that are in the back. A lot of the content that had me and Gary before that, and I want to keep that available and live and up there. I know people are going back and watching those old episodes that folks that had never found Ham Radio Now before recently are going back, and I'm getting comments on all of the shows. So partly what I'm trying to do is making sure that content stays available. There's a lot of good stuff.
There's a lot of great stuff up there.
Yeah, some of it's old and dated, but the reality is, you know, it's ham radio and a lot of fun. So, Darren, AJ6BL, and David, W0DHG, thank you for joining us for episode number 399 and 7/8 ZumSpot Setup.
And thank you for having me.
Oh, yeah, anytime. We'll be back.
Oh, I appreciate
you'll
it.
Be back.
Yes, I'd like to.
I'm going to close it in the regular Ham Radio Now fashion.
Awesome.
I'm going to say.
This time I know what I'm supposed to say.
I'm going to say the first two.
Okay.
Over and
out.
Sweet. I'm going to hit this.